Good morning and welcome to Hope Lutheran Church in Chino Valley, Arizona. We're glad you're joining us today via our live stream, but we're also glad you're here in person this morning. It's nice to have the family back together again, and we're glad to see all of you in one place at one time. So, a joyful day. If any of you have any comments, please see our website where you're at right now and find my email address and send me whatever you want to. I'm always looking forward to seeing what people have to say about our worship services. Today is the Sunday after Easter. It's the day we usually concentrate on doubt because of doubting Thomas. On the Sunday after Easter, Jesus appeared to him too, and he confessed, "My Lord and my God." And that's what we do too as God's people. We do it in our worship, but we also do it with our songs. Today, we begin with our very first hymn, which is "This Joyful Eastertide." Please arise. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given His only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by His authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
For all that we need in life, and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the steadfast assurance that nothing can separate us from your love, and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ.
Christ, have mercy.
For the well-being of your holy church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Merciful God, maker and preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. The works of the Lord are great and glorious. His name is worthy of praise.
O Lord, our Lord, how glorious is your name in all the earth. Almighty God, merciful Father, you crown our life with your love. You take away our sins. You come.
O risen Lord, you came to your disciples and took away their fears with your word of peace. Come to us also by word and sacrament, and banish our fears with the comforting assurance of your abiding presence. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our first lesson for the Sunday after Easter is recorded in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 3, beginning with verse 12, where we pick up on Peter's defense after he healed a lame man. That situation led to his opportunity to share the victory of Jesus Christ, both law and gospel. When Peter saw this, he addressed the people. Men of Israel, why are you amazed at this? Why are you staring at us as if by our own power or godliness we have made this man walk? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our fathers, glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and disowned in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. You disowned the holy and righteous one, and asked to have a murderer given to you. You killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. We are witnesses of this. And on the basis of faith in his name, it is the name of Jesus that has strengthened this man whom you see and know. This faith that comes through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. Now, brothers, I know that you acted in ignorance, just like your leaders. But in this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through the mouth of all the prophets, that his Christ would suffer. Therefore, repent and return to have your sins wiped out, so that refreshing times may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus, the Christ appointed for you. This is God's word. Please join me now in singing Psalm 16. We ask our children to come forward for the children's message, please. It's been so long, you guys probably forgot about how we do this, huh? That's kind of crazy. But, you know, trust is a really big thing in life. And it's so easily broken, don't you think? Let me ask you a question. How in the world did you come to trust your parents? I guess you don't, okay? Well, you know, trust is so tied into love. You know, and parents and kids, by the very nature of the thing, you have to really do something stupid to break love. Or to break trust with your kids, you know, at least when they're little. You know, where did you get your meals from when you were an infant? You got it from the store. This is harder than you think. Before that, well, from mom, right? Yeah, you had nourishment from mom, and mom and dad protected you. They gave you shelter. And so you grow up trusting them. That's the way it is, right? But as we get older, we always want to have proof. So I'm not going to trust you till I know I can trust you, that your words are being followed, right? Isn't that the way that is? And when you get to, well, you're just not quite there, but some of you are getting very close to those high school years. No, son, you're learning all kinds of different things, listening to different voices, and now you challenge your parents. How can I believe you? This person said that. I saw this on my computer, blah, blah, blah. You know, and all of a sudden you have that teen parent stress, and you get doubts. Do my parents still care for me? Well, the same thing happens with our Heavenly Father. And as life goes on, there are many voices in the world that have very much been listened to, even by God's family, God's people, to the point where sometimes God's people stop becoming God's people. They doubt that Christ is really their Savior. Now, why would I bring that up if I didn't know that that was something that happens? And the only way to combat that is to trust in what God has already done. He made promises, and he kept them. I mean, one way to destroy trust is to make a promise and then not keep your promise, right? Well, us humans, we have that problem from time to time, but Jesus never did. He always kept the promises of God to the point that led him to the cross to pay for our sins and his resurrection where he came up triumphant. You can trust him. Thomas needed to learn the lesson. We have to review that lesson every single day. And if we do, we will remember Jesus. We will remain his brothers and sisters. We will remain the children of God to eternal life. And then it'll all be worth it, okay? Now we walk by faith. We'll talk more about that in the sermon this morning. Let's pray, children. Heavenly Father, through your word, keep us from doubting. Keep us trusting that Jesus is our Savior all the days of our lives, no matter what we hear or see in our world. Because in the end, we will see Jesus with our own eyes. As he says to us in the resurrection on the last day, peace be with you. In his name we pray, amen. Thanks, children. Alleluia, alleluia. Christ the Lord is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Blessed are they who have not seen and yet have believed. Alleluia. 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 These words are written that we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God. Out of respect for our Savior, please arise for the Holy Gospel. Today, the Holy Gospel comes to us from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 20, where we hear of Jesus' first visit to his disciples on Easter evening, and also his return visit, that time with Thomas present, on the Sunday after Easter. On the evening of that first day of the week, the disciples were together behind locked doors because of their fear of the Jews. Jesus came, stood among them, and said to them, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. So the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. Just as the Father has sent me, I am also sending you." After saying this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whenever you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. Whenever you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." But Thomas, one of the 12, the one called twin, some of you will remember the Greek word didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples kept telling him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger into the mark of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will never believe." After 8 days, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Take your hand and put it into my side. Do not continue to doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus, in the presence of his disciples, did many other miraculous signs that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. This is the Holy Gospel. Please be seated now as we sing select verses of hymn 165, O Sons and Daughters of the King. Christ the Lord is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. It's difficult sometimes, isn't it, to believe what we cannot see? To believe things that are just spoken and we don't have anything to support it? I think that's true for most of us, even though we weren't born in Missouri. For our children, that's the Show Me State. The fact remains that there are all kinds of philosophies and voices in our world. There are all kinds of religious systems that we can look at. There are all kinds of, and you can fill in the blank if you want, of things that stand contrary to what the simple truths of God's Word in His Bible say. How can you believe in the resurrection from the dead? Have you ever seen somebody who is dead alive again? Have you? Not physically, I haven't. Spiritually, yeah. Looking at you. Thomas was that disciple who happened not to be with the other disciples. Where he was, who knows? Maybe he went to McDonald's or, you know, a place like that. But he certainly wasn't there with his disciples. They were locked up for fear of the Jews. One wonders why he wasn't there with them in fear as well. But when he returns, he finds out that Jesus already had visited them, leaving them with his peace. Remember, they were filled with fear. And remember what Thomas says? Unless I see, unless I touch, I won't believe. In order for Thomas to have the victory of Jesus, he needed to come to faith in the resurrection of Jesus. Because without the resurrection, there's no victory. You and I who live in a world that's filled with all kinds of competing thoughts and ideas. All you have to do is watch a couple of different news channels about one story, and you can figure that out. And because of that, there is no peace. In our world, people are always pitted against other people so that somebody else can get control or be right or whatever it is. But not for God's people. Not for you and for me. Because if we want to share in Jesus' victory, we need to know something. Jesus is alive. And that's the one thing that keeps us going through the highs and lows of life, through the times of doubt and the times when we're pretty solid, when death strikes, and when life seems to be rolling merrily along. There's one thing that always has to be there. For believers to share in the victory, we need to trust Jesus lives. Now, the text for today is the epistle for the Sunday after Easter. It comes to us from St. John's first letter, chapter 5. And these aren't easy verses in the scriptures. Everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. And everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. This is how we know that we love the children of God. God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. And his commands are not burdensome, for everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. This is God's Word. There are three reasons that John talks about here to convince us that believers share in Jesus' victory. The first one, because they have been born of God. Believers have been born again, simple as that. Every single person that confesses Jesus Christ as their Savior has been born again. Now, that's a very popular theme of St. John. If we go to his gospel in the very first chapter, It says there, everyone who believes that Jesus Christ is born of God. And then in John 1:13, they were born not of blood or by the desire of the flesh or by a husband's will, but born of God. And when we're given that insight into that discussion that Jesus has with Nicodemus, remember that? That's also in John 3. Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." How can someone be born when they are old? Nicodemus asked. You can just see Jesus' frustration if you read the whole chapter. It's like he hits his head and goes, "What? You're Israel's teacher. You don't know this. Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born," he says. And Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit." Now, there are different words that we have in the scriptures that talk about this. One is conversion, right? The picture there is you're going one way and then you turn around and go the other direction. Going to hell in unbelief, turned around, going to heaven, you know, with faith. Another word is the word that's used here. Born again in the Greek is regeneration. Then there are other words, of course, you know, about coming to faith. But that's what St. John is talking about in the epistle for today, what he talked about in his gospel. Because unless you are born of God, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Without faith in Jesus, you cannot get to heaven. I know that's not popular in our world today where culture's being thrown out the window, right? But we live in a world that doesn't get it. They're happy and they're spiraling down into hell. I don't know about you, but I'm not happy about that. Christ's blood went out for every single human that's ever lived. He cared that much for every single person that we can care no less than that. But by God's grace, we are able to know the truth, even though we can't prove it, because we are the children of God. We are the children of God. Well, how do you know that? How do you know that? See, it's not because you believe. The Bible never uses the word because with faith. Did you know that? You cannot find it there. I've already done that. I looked at every time the word pistis or pistin is used in the Greek, pistoio, the Greek word for faith or to believe. And not once do you have cause with it. We have a Greek scholar here, so he can check that up for us, yeah. Now, it's really important, though, to understand that. Faith is a vehicle through which God gives us what Jesus did. It's the receptor. But it's really important what you believe in, because there are tons of people that believe in all kinds of things today. Is it saving faith? We'll talk more about that in our Bible class this morning. John says, everyone who believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. How do you know if you are a child of God? Do you believe it? Simple as that. And everyone who loves the Father loves his child as well. The Father, God the Father, you love God, the creator and preserver of all things? Yeah. Well, how can you not love his Son then too? Now we can get into the Trinity as well. I told you this is a tough section of the scripture. This is how we know that we love the children of God, by loving God and carrying out his commands. In fact, this is love for God, to keep his commands. We love the Father even as we have loved the Son, because we've been called to faith. And that happened through the washing waters of baptism connected with the Word. It happens every time the Word of God is proclaimed and somebody believes it. Or as St. Paul said, don't you know that all of us who are baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death. That's what happened when we were baptized. In order that, here's a purpose clause, the purpose for that. Just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly also be united with him in a resurrection like his. How do you know you're the child of God? You've been born again. God called you to faith. The Holy Spirit created it in your heart, and you are his child. And nobody can change that. But it's still by faith, isn't it? Children, even as children share in the inheritance of their parents, we as the children of God share in Jesus' victory. By faith, we have what Jesus did. I don't know about you, but that kind of warms my heart a little bit. I've lived long enough to know how easy it is to doubt God's promises. You're expecting something to happen, right? You're praying about it. You lost your job and you're praying for a new one. Is God unfaithful when he lets you without a job for a time? But during those times, the doubts come. Does God really love me? And the devil gets us to turn our attention to ourselves and to our situation instead of turning to the one who gives us life and eternal life. You know what I'm talking about? Or you pray for your grandfather that he doesn't die because he has a triple skull fracture. And you pray like crazy. And God answers the prayer, and he gets well, gets back to work, only to find out he has terminal cancer and then has a really terrible 6 years. See, God has our lives and our eternities in his hands. He already has given us the victory. We just haven't been able to realize it yet in its fullness. That'll come on Judgment Day. We, the children of God, share in Jesus' victory because we have overcome the world. We are victorious. What does it mean to overcome? You know, this weekend, for all you golf enthusiasts, I usually don't use a lot of sports illustrations, but for all you sports enthusiasts, what's going on this week in the golf world? It's the Masters tournament, the first of the four majors in golf. And it's a ridiculous golf course there in Augusta, Georgia. And you could be a fraction of an inch off, and that ball's going to roll backwards into the water. You can actually hit a very good shot, and it takes the wrong bounce because of the hills and undulations that are there, and it could be a mess. It's what happens in golf all the time. And you look, who's going to overcome? Well, they're the ones that can overcome a triple bogey. In the world of pro golf, that doesn't happen very often, but at the Masters, it's regular. To overcome means to have problems, have challenges, look at issues, and still get past them to the end of the game, to the victory. Now think of that when we see these verses. For everyone born of God overcomes the world. Just think of the things you've overcome so far in your lives. There's been a few, I'm pretty sure, unless you're only like 2 years old, then maybe not so many yet. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one who believes that Jesus is the Son of God. Yes, there are many challenges to faith that challenge our victory. We live through them time after time after time, and every time we turn to the Lord, don't we? God, you are God. I trust in you. You will do what is best for me eternally. Thirdly, believers share in the victory of Jesus because they believe the testimony. Now, we have a number of witnesses that John brings up in the text here. First one is Jesus' life himself. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not only come by water, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies because the Spirit is the truth. Now, this has troubled Bible scholars for centuries. What in the world is John talking about? There's all kinds of answers to this if you read the commentaries. But I'm kind of simple. So when I look at this and study this in the context of John's writings, it becomes pretty obvious to me that he's talking about the blood, the water part, is baptism. Yeah, he came, that was the start of his ministry, right? By water. And then by blood, that's the end of his ministry, right? shed his blood on the cross. Kind of makes sense that he's talking about his ministry from the beginning to the end. Not his whole life, but his ministry. And of course, the resurrection caps that. And so we have the witness of Jesus' baptism, where the whole Trinity is involved, right? The witness of the triune God is there. And what are they saying? This very thing. He is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but for the sins of the whole world. That's the whole witness of the triune God. That's why Jesus was promised, why he was sent, why he completed his work, and that he's coming again, right? It's all that very thing, that he's the atoning sacrifice. And so we hear the witness of the triune God as well. The hard thing is our own witness, huh? What kind of witness are you for Jesus? Yeah, I know. This is the time of the sermon everybody puts their heads down. He's talking about me. Well, I'm talking about myself, too. It's not easy to share the gospel because we sometimes get all bogged down in our own lives. And then Sunday mornings, we're really kind to each other, and then we go into our jobs or at home or in our neighbors, and then we yell at them, and we talk badly, or we talk behind their back, or we talk about secrets. Don't tell that. Remember what Jesus said, or John said earlier? And he's really mouthing Jesus' words. He said, people will know you're my disciples if you love one another. Jesus said that. That fits to this context as well. How do we bear witness to the fact that we are resurrection Christians, that we live a resurrection faith? Well, it's the way we act towards other people. Love one another as God has loved you. And how do we do that witness? By being very conscious of a number of things. One, Jesus died for everybody and rose for everybody. Second, we know that only through the gospel does the Holy Spirit work faith in somebody's heart. And God put us in the world, thirdly, to affect other people. Whether that's in our families, in our marriages, in our world, doesn't matter. God didn't set us in the world to be by ourselves, hibernating. We do it in many ways. Congregationally, we do it through outreach programs, and we show our love to others through our food program. But the best thing you could do is just love somebody. Even if they get angry with you or cuss you out or whatever, still people will know that you are a child of God because you love no matter what they do to you. What kind of witness are you? Are you one like Jesus Christ himself who allowed people to crucify him? Because he loved the world so much. Remember, God so loved the world he gave? If we are to be witnesses in our world as the children of God who have been born again, we will keep God's command to love one another, even as God has loved us. And we will show our love for God by staying in the Word and in worship. I said today, it's a nice day. We're finally back together in one service with everybody, although, I noticed some people are gone today, still vacationing or away for Easter and their week later. But it's still nice to see everybody together. Because we are the family of God. And the family of God wants to bear witness to the truth. Jesus came. Jesus lived perfectly for us. Jesus died in our place on the cross. We are forgiven. We have peace with God. We are God's children now and forever. And then we leave here and we go out and we bear witness to our Savior by our actions and by our lives. Yes, it's true that we're going to have doubts from time to time. And every once in a while, that sinful nature is going to say, God, prove it to me. Then remember, God already has. Just read about it. God kept his promises, every one of them. Well, except one. That one he's going to keep. It just hasn't been kept yet when he returns. You can trust in this God because it is the only way you have eternal life. Jesus Christ wins. And because he wins, we win. Christ the Lord is risen.
He's risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Please join with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we continue to live in a world that has so many different philosophies, thoughts, ways of life, we pray that you would help us to keep focused on Jesus' ministry, the water, and then the end, his blood, shed on the cross for the sins of the world, and so for our sins too. Lord, help us to look at his victory, his resurrection, because We know he was handed over to death for our sins and raised to life for our justification. Lord, keep us in the faith. Keep us your children until the day we actually rejoice in seeing and being a part of the victory that now we know by faith. Heavenly Father, bless us for Jesus' sake. Amen. Please arise now and join with me as we respond to God's word by confessing the Christian faith. This morning we use the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all
that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated. Please rise and join with me in prayer. God of all grace, we thank you for the gift of eternal life through your Son. By the resurrection of Jesus from the dead and by the faithful testimony of the apostles, you have assured us that our faith stands on a sure and solid foundation, that we have the victory, that we will overcome. Though we do not see Jesus with our physical eyes, help us see him with the eyes of faith. Through your Holy Spirit, breathe on your church that it may faithfully proclaim the gospel of our risen Savior with courage and diligence in all lands and to all people. Grant that we also may be illumined by the heavenly light of your word and so keep us in the one and only true faith. Preserve us from all assaults on our souls. Deliver us from doubt and despair, and preserve us from worldly wisdom and false teaching. Forgive the sins of your people. Strengthen the doubting and faithless. Bring back the forgetful and wayward, and comfort the anxious and distressed. Lord, hear us now as we bring to you our private petitions and prayers. As we go from this place today, grant peace and rest to us all. We pray this in the name of Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now receive with believing hearts the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look on you with favor and grant you peace.
Amen, amen, amen.
Please be seated as our live stream worship portion concludes. We sing, Oh Sing Jubilee to the Lord. We hear our Wisconsin Lutheran Seminary choir sing that.
Oh, sing jubilee to the Lord, every land.
Glory, glory be to God.
Oh, serve him with gladness and sing his songs we stand. Sing praises to God out of
Zion.
He made us his own, he has given us bread.
Glory, glory be to God.
The sheep of his pasture.
For joining with us this day at Hope Lutheran Church, and we pray that God grant you a safe and blessed week in the risen Savior Jesus Christ. Hope to see you next week. God bless.